Yashodanandana Vrajajana Ranjana Yashodanandana Vrajajana Ranjana Yamuna Tiravanachari Yamuna Tiravanachari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Gopi Janavallabha Girivaradhari Yashodanandana Vraja Janaranjana Yamuna Tiravanachari Yamuna Tiravanachari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Jaya Radha Gopinath Radha Gopinath Radhe Jaya Gaura Nitai Jaya Gaura Nitai Jaya Gaura Nitai Jaya Gaura Nitai Jaya Shri Gopal, Shri Gopal, Shri Gopal, Jaya Shri Gopal. Jaya Jaya Prabhupad, 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 Prabhupad. Jaya Jaya Gurudev, 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 Gurudev. God Premanandi. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Narayanam Namaskrityam Naram Chaiva Narottamam Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam Tatho Jaya Mudirae Nashta Praeshu Abhadreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavati Uttama Shloke Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtaki. So we are reading today from, continuing to read from the Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 22, chapter entitled Elements of Material Creation, text number 13. Please repeat after me. Sattvam Jnanam Raja Karma Tamo Jnanam Ihochate Guna Vyatikara Kala Svabhava Sutram Evacha Sattvam Jnanam Raja Karma Tamo Jnanam Ihochate Guna Vyatikara Kala Svabhava Sutram Evacha Sattvam Jnanam Raja Karma Tamo Jnanam Ihochate Guna Vyatikara Kala Svabhava Sutram Evacha Sattvam Jnanam Raja Karma Tamo Jnanam Ihochate Guna Vyatikara Kala Svabhava Sutram Evacha. Sattvam Jnanam Raja Karma Tamo Jnanam Ihochate Guna Vyatikara Kala Svabhava Sutram Evacha. Matajis. Sattvam Jnanam Raja Karma Tamo Jnanam Ihochate Guna Vyatikara Kala Svabhava Sutram Evacha. Sattvam, the mode of goodness. Jnanam, knowledge. Rajaha, the mode of passion. Karma, fruitive work. Tama, the mode of ignorance. Ajnanam, foolishness. Iha, in this world. Uchyate is called guna of the modes. Vyatikara, the agitated transformation. Kala, time. Svabhava, innate tendency. Nature. Sutram, the Mahatattva. Eva, indeed. Cha, also. Translation and purport by disciples of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation. In this world, the mode of goodness is recognized as knowledge, the mode of passion as fruitive work, and the mode of darkness as ignorance. Time is perceived as the agitated interaction of the material modes, and the totality of functional propensity is embodied by the primeval sutra, or Mahatattva. Purport. The impetus for the interaction of the material elements is the forward movement of time. Because time is passing, the embryo grows within the womb, gradually comes out, grows up, produces byproducts, dwindles and dies. All of this is due to the pushing of time. In the absence of the time factor, the material elements do not interact but remain inert in the form of pradana. Lord Krishna is establishing the basic categories of the material world so that human beings can conceive of the Lord's creation. Were the categories not condensed, analysis and conceptualization would be impossible, since the Lord's potencies are infinite. Although there are numerous divisions of material elements within the basic divisions, the spirit soul is always to be understood as a distinct transcendental element meant for residence in the kingdom of God. Om Ajnan Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namah Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamsa Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamsha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prastaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Asyata Desha Tarine Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasadi Gaur Bhaktavrinda Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. So, in this purport and translation, the central point that is apparent is the time factor. And while it is a subject which we all feel we are well aware and we are familiar with on a daily basis, but it is something which is all-powerful, and that's what would be the subject of our discussions today. When Srila Prabhupada named the Chicago deities Kishore Kishori, I think to my mind that's probably the only deities where the name Radha Krishna is not directly linked. Of course, they are Radha and Krishna. But in that, at the time of his giving the naming ceremony of the Chicago, he mentioned that they are eternally Kishore and Kishori. That means they are eternally youthful. They are beyond the concept of time. They are transcendental to time, of course. And he also said that nobody else can be beyond the in that position, because the body has to go through the six transformations, as is mentioned here in the purport, that the body is born, then it gives some byproducts, it grows up, it produces offspring, it grows old, and then it dies. Every body means every living entity, or everything in the material creation, not just living entity, everything in the living material. So from the Himalayan mountains to the insects, everybody is eventually conquered by the passage of time. So, so Prabhupada mentioned that this is what we should be always aware of, that time is growing on us. He also mentioned on another occasion in connection to time, that there was a discussion about the economic status and how countries which have progressed over the last 30-40 years, that they, one of the reasons is because their birth rate also comes down, their death rate also comes down because of the improvement in medical facilities, health conditions. So Prabhupada said, death rate is 100%. Coming down means when you, because I remember reading that it is, it used to be 3.5%, 3.5 per thousand, and then in India it came down to 2.5, and now it's considered a healthy state if it's below 1.5 per thousand. But it never struck me as when Prabhupada mentioned this that, but ultimately it's 100%, it's not 1.5 or 0.5 or 2, everybody has to die. So, but the fact is that this is never, it's a frightening situation perhaps that nobody discusses that. But it's also a fact that why Prabhupada mentioned, which is also again news to probably all of us, that the four main problems, whenever any big issues come up, there's a crisis in someone's life or in a country's life, he would say the major four problems are birth, old age, disease and death. This is among the things that you would constantly read. And it is a fact because the old age, for instance, it's a very, very, it's a miserable situation. It's a very difficult situation. And believe me, because I'm seeing it now gradually, so I can see the changes that happen. And everybody has to go through it. Everybody, every single person will experience it. So there are only two things that will happen. Either you die young, or you die a miserable old death. Miserable means, yes, of course, if a person is Krishna conscious, definitely there will be, we are not pure devotees, but to a large extent, we would understand how to face it. We would also know how to take help and, at least our mind, because ultimately the happiness is a state of mind. But nevertheless, we don't get used to the fact that the body is relatively speaking growing, and the bones start creaking, the joints are paining, the teeth start falling off, you get arthritis, you have this, you have that. It just happens with the passage of time. So someone will say, he's 95, you may have some, but ultimately whether it's 85, 75, 95, eventually it's a matter of time. So when we talk of Himalayan mountains or elephants or down to insects which have just moments to live, the passage of time will destroy everything. But the amazing thing is that as we understand it is Maya, which really gives us the feeling when we are young, we think that it is going to remain forever. If you reflect back, nobody would think in the young age where that, theoretically we may think as we are growing older that even now when we are probably in our 20s, 30s, 40s also, 50s also perhaps, that we hear about this in our spiritual lectures and Bhagavatams, in the scriptures. So we think, yes, it will happen someday. But we don't get that realization, we do not know how temporary it is. And when we've had quite a few devotees in the last, say, 1-2 years, whom we've known and who have departed, many of them suddenly, and it's going to happen every year because even our congregation is growing, the movement is also growing old. So when we see that, then we get that jolt, we have that realization. But again, to capture that in our minds, to know that it is actually a reality which is so present, that we cannot talk of whether we, with certainty that we have, whether we have 1 day or 1 year or 5 years or 10 years, that's beyond us. So when we are young, we will be thinking that, like when we are going to school, we hate to go to school. Children generally don't like to go to school because there is a, at that age, for the child, it is like a, intimidating experience means you have, you know, there's a regulative aspect, you know, you have to be present, and then there are tests and exams, and sometimes you're punished, whatever. So the child is always thinking that, you know, I wish I can, you know, when I grow old, like I should be like my father or mother, you know, they're free, they're so happy. And then, but when we're growing older, most people you meet will say that, oh, the school days were the best. And then when you try and tell your child that, you know, actually you don't know, you are going through the best phase of your life, enjoy it. It will never register in the child's mind, because the child is not satisfied. The child feels that my parent is not going to school, so he must be happy. So the concept of time is relative, the concept of happiness also is relative to you know, the factor that I am just, the absence of some miserable aspect is happiness. So this this happens in our life whether we are, when we are growing older. So we miss a lot of our time period going through those we miss the passage of time. And then when we see in the newspapers also, in the obituaries, somebody close to us, or some, even if you have, if you don't know someone, but we typically open the Times of India obituaries and you see the pictures. Many times, you know, it may be somebody who's left his or her body 10 years ago, 5 years ago, on that day, there's a remembrance. But usually they'll have a, you know, a very happy smile, smiling face, youthful face, glowing skin. So the world gives us the impression that, you know, things are happy, things are going to be there, and, you know, we get the impression and we come to the conclusion that we are happy and we are, we have a lot of time, we have, and it's going to be continuing like this. If we may not admit it, but back of our mind it is that it will go on indefinitely. So Prahlad Maharaj explains that everyone is working to better their life with some material desires. You know, everybody's thing. So we are always living in hope, thinking that something will happen, something better. So we are always, that's how our time factor goes. You know, when we're young, as I said, we were looking that, okay, when I grow up, it'll be, and I remember very distinctly when I was in school, I used to really feel that, you know, because you have to have 100% attendance, you can't bunk. And my brother was in college, I used to feel that he's so lucky because you don't have to give attendance, you can, you know, you are completely free. You can do what you want. Then when I was in college, I was thinking, my father, he's, what does he do? He just goes to the office, puts his feet up, I mean, relaxed, he has nothing to do, he's so happy. But that time you don't conceptualize so much, then you have to work, you have to take responsibility, then you have family, you have these problems, that you cannot. So because of the limitations of our mind, we come to conclusions based on our immediate factor, and if it is devoid of any spiritual Krishna consciousness or any connection which can give us the perspective of life as a whole, we would come to so limited understanding that actually we live our life accordingly, moment to moment, you know, picking up this, picking up that, and therefore we are very, you can say, in the hands of our senses, because the senses are the ones which are giving us our immediate joys. So then I would say, this gives me happiness, this does not give me happiness, I avoid this, I do that. So literally, my weekdays are difficult, I'm looking for weekends, evenings are difficult, I go to movies, I'm just looking for that. So I look forward to that, then you again, you have a miserable time, then you look for, so it is like an escaping, and when you're going through that cycle, and then you come back and escaping, so then that momentary happiness gives us, so in this way, time gets completely beyond us, and we are, it is going away out of our hands. Even in spiritual life, when we come to spiritual life also, when we come and we hear about the reality of life, what who Krishna is and what our life is and what the soul is and who the Supreme Soul is, what our relationship is, what we should do, it doesn't become much easier, because it, from the mental to the realizing and actual, there is always a time gap. And that's that comes through sadhana, that comes through association, that comes through observing others, where we can implement what we've heard. But initially what happens is that we do Why initially? I mean, periodically, right through our lives, even if we are there for 10, 20 years, it's quite, it depends on our state of mind, that we do feel that we postpone things. We know this is the right thing, I will do it, but I have to got this to do, I've got that to do. I will just, young people would say that, you know, first let me get married, first let me get settled, then I come to spiritual life, take it up more seriously. I want to do this, I want to do that service, but first let me do this, let me do this. So our priorities will be according to our immediate needs. So often we lapse into it. And my point is not that we have to avoid the responsibility. You know, we have to take a totality, we have to have all the responsibilities. But many things can happen concurrently. We try to think that priority means that I should completely exclude some part and take up only some part. Well, in fact, we are actually every day, every moment, we are living several parts. So we are in a position to take up many responsibilities. Like right now, every one of us, we are simultaneously many roles. We may be, we are a son to our parents and we do our duties. We are also, in many cases, a mother or father to our children. We are also probably having grandparents. Then we also have, we are a citizen. So we are also part of the city, a community, a country. Like all these are various responsibilities and we are responsible. So depending on what comes up immediately, what comes up later, but all of them are there and we are not oblivious of these responsibilities. So this responsibility of a human being having a limited amount of time and how much we within that pack into our life is really where and value every moment is really our challenge. So we do have a tendency to postpone and say we'll do this later, we'll do that later, not knowing that time is going past us. And especially when the prime of youth, when we have the energy, enthusiasm in the peak, that it becomes, it's a tragedy, it's a pity that when we have so much to offer, rather than when we are much older, we may be wiser perhaps, but at that time, so many things we want to do, you can't do because mind is working fast, but body has limitations. So Krishna, Prabhupada's gift is, we can appreciate, you know, from that context that the whole world has been revealed to us, a completely new world, which has come only because of his, and today happens to be the day that he arrived in the US, is it? Yeah. Today is the day when he, 54 years ago, he actually arrived in the US. When he arrived in Boston, you know, he said, I came to the Boston Harbor and I did not know whether I should go left or right. So from that moment, I didn't know anyone, no money. From that moment, for the next 12 years, how did he spend his time? If you're talking of time, you don't even have to look beyond him to just have a complete example of how to utilize time. It's a complete, encyclopedia of time management. Just understanding him, because he understood that every moment was precious. And he was packing so many things into it, but on a, such a personal human level. So we were talking of old age, that, and this is a, with all the technology, with all the modern progress, so-called material progress that is there, nevertheless, every country in the world, and particularly the Western countries actually have a growing problem of what to do with the old age, because today's progress has come by at the means of on an individualistic approach rather than families. There's a breakdown of families with the result that in old age, in most cases, we see that they're left to themselves and old people do not have much of a voice. I mean, where is the, first of all, the energy levels, their memories, you know, their even the mental capacity to stand up and, you know, that fighting spirit, it just diminishes, you know, diminishes. So we take for granted, you know, there are some old people there and at times, we may, even among families, we may have love and respect, but it's like you do the needful, you know, but then they are like, you can say, part of a family, but not the, they are never the core. It rarely becomes a core because of the, just the fact that they are growing older. So with the result that we cannot understand what old age is. That's the beauty of Maya's influence. I shouldn't say beauty, but that's the reality. It's amazing how it completely covers us, that we read about it, we hear about it, but we cannot see that how old age can really is creeping up, because we can't experience it. And what we can't experience, we can understand mentally up to a point, but experience is always the best teacher, and that happens only when you experience it. And then you know every step is tentative. You don't, you know, when you're climbing a step also, you're not sure whether you put your foot the right way or not. Now, these are basic things. The child will run up and down. So, but nobody, you know, so from that moment, there is, and if you're not having a Krishna conscious understanding, you can see that among most old people. You really feel the old people who are smiling, happy. They're generally very dejected or looking down. Maybe there's a fear, constant worry, apprehension. Then we also have our attachments. So, we can't appreciate what old age is, and that is another, we should be grateful that through the eyes of Shastra, we get a very close glimpse of what, because old age is closest to death. Now, if you're going to, if we don't know, but if you're going to die at 20, then 19 is also old age. But we don't know. That is why Prahlad Maharaj says that, he was telling his friends that, don't waste your time. You know, don't think. He said, don't think. And this is in Satya Yuga. He said, don't think that, you know, you're going to live a long life. You could die tomorrow. Now, imagine, he's 5 years old, he's telling his friends in Satya Yuga that you could die tomorrow. So, what to speak of Kali Yuga when life expectancy is just a fraction of what it was. So, keeping that in mind, we really need to take up, you know, what these are the meditation on our, on the Shastra, what we read, what we hear, what we observe, is what will make us connected more to the real life. The first step is, of course, to read or to hear or to come in contact. But most important, what we have in our control is we focus on many things. So which focuses are going to be, if this is becomes a focus, we meditate on it, think about it, observe, and then, and it's amazing how our Shastra is actually written so many yugas ago, are actually, you know, you see that, you know, the eternal truths are, the axiomatic truths are, you know, opening up to us, and we actually experience it. So when we make that connection, then it will increase our faith, and also it will help us in how we counter. That some things are, many things are in our control, then we just try to transcend it. Like Prabhupada said, you know, in his last days, he said, don't think that will not happen to you. When they saw that, you know, he had given up eating and practically not even drinking anything, he had become a, his body was just a bag of bones practically. And it was really a shock to all his disciples because they were very young still. But he said, don't think that will not happen to you. So his life also was an example of how we should depart and how we could face it. So it is said that the greatest danger in life is to forget Krishna. And that Vishnu Puran says that at the time of death, you know, if you forget, that's the, no greater inauspiciousness, no greater tragedy than to waste a moment in developing our relationship with Krishna. But then you have the other extreme, that in the this last century only, one of the, perhaps one of the most creative geniuses of the last several decades, when he died, because of his lack of understanding of what life is about, he actually wrote that after I die, and he was so confident that science will prove everything, that he said, you just pack my body with ice and store it, because they, I'm sure in 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, they'll be able to create life and I'll come back to life. Now imagine a creative genius, means Krishna's gift to him was something unparalleled. But when it came down to what even, you know, a simple person without academic education, but with common sense and has heard something about Krishna consciousness, would be able to say that how foolish this is. But this is the thing, that how we can get caught up, and especially if things go our way. If we are successful and if we are doing well and we think that we are the masters of how our progress and destiny is, then we come to the conclusion that we have our own key to happiness and to future. And then, okay, if it is a matter of old age, I'm sure, because we are hearing so many so-called post-dated checks, as Prabhupada said, you know, from science, that, well, we will do this in future, we'll do that, we'll do this. Prabhupada was challenging that all the time. So, keeping that in mind, or seeing these examples also, and in today's world, when we talk of progress, we need to see where we focus our attention and our dedicate our life. So, an example is given, or an analogy about, like today we have in the material world, you know, people would like to grow rich, people would like to have enough for the future, so they grow wealth. That means they make investments. So, Prabhupada would give a very nice example. Often he would speak about this, that just like you're investing in your, whichever way, whether it's in property or in somehow you are creating a healthy bank balance, you know, you may improve your job prospects, whatever. But the, so that is something which is for the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years, whatever time we have, and then you may want to leave to for your future. But what about the investment that we can make in our spiritual life, for our spiritual life, by utilizing our time? Because the greatest wealth we have, the greatest wealth of all, is time. And because it is something which we cannot see, smell, hear, understand, conceive, it's imperceptible, therefore we just look at it, okay, we think, and also what happens is that because we like today, for instance, they say, we came to temple at 8 o'clock, tomorrow I'll come at 8 o'clock. So we feel tomorrow is the same as today. But we don't know that every moment has gone. Every moment has gone is gone. It's very difficult, it is a reality, but it's difficult to capture, to live that and understand that. So what is gone is completely gone forever. By the time I finish speaking this sentence, so much of time has gone, it's gone. That's finished. Means it's out of our life, now we have progressed towards leaving this world. So, every step brings us closer to death. So, keeping that in mind, we understand that there is a temporary window we have in this human form, and then to get an understanding of how important this investment would be, if we were given that opportunity, if, hypothetically, that we could actually understand and see and feel all our past lives. Now, we know through the Shastra that we've all gone through the evolutionary process of you know, every fish life, you know, and when we see fish in the sea get swallowed up, or whether it get killed or whatever, and then it may, we don't know how many times we've gone through that. Maybe we progress from a small fish to a big fish to a bigger fish, we don't know, but finally we've gone through other species. Plant species, animal species, every species we go through, just see the whole cycle would have gone through. All that has gone through, and just imagine if you can go through, you know, you've also been growing old in that, and then dying, and then again new life. So if we were given that chance, and to understand that, and then we, after millions of lives, we've come to human form, we would really value, really, really value that. Wow, I've got something which is, it's like, a flash. I've just got it for a second, so I'm waiting for, if I get it, let me utilize the best way. So in the context of time, in the context of all these yugas and eons, this one human life is, and this understanding in that, of what we have been given, is really, really not even a flash of a moment. It's so, so small. So therefore, if we are, somehow if we are able to appreciate what we have, it also has the benefit of also making our life much smoother, because one is to know that time is valuable, but how to spend our time, and therefore we will be able to more tolerate more, because when we appreciate and when we are really grateful for what we have, not only the fact that Krishna has given us this understanding and this life, that we've come across Srila Prabhupada and then our Guru, our many devotees, Radha Krishna, Radha Gopinath, so many examples we have. So that all that appreciation and gratitude, and if you have a family which is also supportive, many things if we look for, then it gives us that determination and to tolerate what we need. And ultimately, rather than hankering and lamenting, which are the bane of our life, if you are able to appreciate and tolerate, that really counters the hankering and lamenting. So, because otherwise our life is just, you know, hankering, I wish I had this. And then when we, like we talked about, now you're growing older, and I wish I was young, I could have done this differently. If I could have done this, I could have done that. So many times we may think that, you know, I wish I knew that this stock was going to grow up and I would invest here. I wish I would, you know, I could have married here, I could have done this. So many things may come, we may never admit what kind of thoughts go in our mind. Just lamenting, or hankering, I wish this happens, that happens. So instead of that, here, when we appreciate and we're grateful, then we are able to tolerate also, because so many things happen which we have to just accept it, that it is our karma or our or Krishna's purifying us, both probably. And that life is short, and we see this, so many disasters and deaths happen regularly around us, constantly, you know, and it's happening with more frequency, the larger impacts, you know, accidents may happen, you know, rainy season has gone through, diseases come through, you know, buildings crash, so many things happen. Now, we may just read in the paper, but imagine if you are there. I mean, or if you know someone who's there, it's such a tragedy, but you know, it can be life-changing for the person. And if you do not have that understanding that where we come from and how we have to accept things, it can be completely devastating. So, because usually more and more unexpected natures do happen. So, if you just reflect also on the time factor, which Krishna's energy is, and how powerful it is, that we cannot stop it for a second. Right? We talked about like how seconds, in the last, when I started saying, but maybe 10 seconds have gone. Seconds go into minutes, minutes go into hours, hours go into days, into weeks, into months, into years, into decades, into centuries, into eons, into yugas, millenniums, right? I mean, we are going through all this, and everything gets destroyed. Everything will be destroyed until it goes back to Krishna, and then everything comes back. So and yet we can't stop it. You may take a clock and take the battery out and say, time band ho gaya. Time is not stopped. Time is ticking. You can't do anything about it. So every second is passing means we are growing older. So that is for us to realize how we are able to accept this and embrace it, and then eagerly take the advantage of utilizing our time, and happily do it, you know, in the association of devotees. So everything revolves around our time factor, because you know, we say, I used to do this, that is also time, so it's all relative. I am doing this, it's also time. I will do this, it's also time. Our impressions of the past, when you talk of past, see, impression of the past or our observations of the present, our aspirations of fear for the future, we talk of past, present, future, it's time. You know, everything is related to time. Now, when you say past means those were the good old days when I was 50 years ago, or day before yesterday I was, you know, doing this, and I almost had an accident, my bus almost crashed. Like, whatever we say in matter of time, we have to understand how the movement is influencing us. Like, it's the power of time, we cannot stop it, we cannot do anything about it. So, therefore, the Shastras say that just like we reciprocate with Krishna, a devotee will reciprocate with Krishna because, say, for instance, why do we offer prasad before eating? Because Krishna has given us food, and with our gratitude, everything that comes from Him, we offer it to Him before we eat. So therefore, we offer to Krishna. That's a reciprocation of love. Similarly, we also have our senses. Krishna has given us these senses, so we can utilize it in Krishna's service in as much as we can, ideally all the time. That is also reciprocation of love. So in the same way, time is also Krishna's gift to us, and therefore, as we said, this is a human form which is rare. So how we utilize that is also our reciprocation to Krishna of our love or absence of Krishna in our life. It depends how we utilize it. So therefore, when Radhanath Maharaj was mentioning once that, you know, all the injunctions of the Vedas are there to assist and support the two most important rules. If you take out all others, the only two rules for anyone, he says, always remember Krishna, never forget Krishna. So he made the point that the word always and never are also time. Always means eternally, never means never, you know. So again, it is reflection of time. So, which means every moment. Therefore, so the greatest danger, greatest of all dangers is to forget Krishna. The greatest benediction is to remember Krishna. While on the other hand, in modern life, we see that what happens when we have absence of Krishna? Because we hear often that, he departed, for a departed soul, you know, he really lived life fully, right? He lived life to the fullest extent, lived life king size. But what this meant is that he enjoyed every moment. The enjoyment means, you know, he really, but we see that if there is no absence of Krishna, and if you are actually defying the rules of, if you are completely agnostically living a life, then karmic reactions will take place. So it is foolishness that we may have got a temporary period of temporary happiness, and that at the expense of, you know, so it's a very bad deal. What you've got, you know, you've taken 5 rupees and given away a crore, something like that. So, you know, you have actually wasted it. So therefore, if you understand that whatever we do, it's another example is like if you, for a person who's enjoying every moment, thinking he's enjoying, it's really like a sheep who are in the queue for getting slaughtered. The sheep are busy having grass and they're feeling happy, but they don't know that 2 sheep ahead or 3 sheep ahead, their turn is going to come and they're going to be killed. So somebody who's not understanding that this is life is temporary and it could stop any time, and if I've wasted this rare opportunity to understand why am I here, who I am, and what I should be doing, what is my connection to my Creator, etc., would be a great tragedy. Yeah, and then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu tells Sanatana Goswami that the 3 most essential and eternal truths are the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Bhakta, that is the devotee, and the process of devotion. So Ishwar, Bhakta and Bhakti. So if we live our life according to how an aspiring devotee should be trying to remember Krishna as much as we can, then to that extent we will be protecting ourselves from a possible fall down. So we are aspiring to be bhakta, and the process of devotion, bhakti, which Krishna has repeatedly said in Bhagavad Gita, beyond means it's there is complete clarity that he not only says time I am, which we've discussed, but he also says that my devotee will never perish, that I will always protect what you have and provide what you lack. So Krishna is always, he's giving overwhelming proof that bhakti is the best process, the process of devotion. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also says this. So ultimately, if we concentrate on the process, and that process means whatever, whether we are a student in Mumbai or whether we are staying somewhere in a small village in, say, in South America, whichever part of the world, whatever our condition, whether we are a man or woman, whether we are educated or not, it is, this rules are applicable across for any human being. And Krishna gives many proofs to say that why he loves his devotees to such an extent that he becomes subordinate to his devotee. He says that, he proves that many, many times. Like we hear in the Krishna book that he has his wrestling matches with his gopas and cowherd friends, and he loves to lose to them, and then he in fact carries them on his back. And the rules of the game are that whoever loses, that team has to carry the winners on their back. Now, bewildering to understand, but it is from a point of knowing that how much he loves. Like just like a father loves his child, the father will be crawling on his knees and, you know, putting his child on his back, you know, and walking around. Now, Prabhupada mentioned this once, that the Prime Minister of England, he talked about that somebody was waiting for him to wait outside his office, and for some time he didn't come. Then when he went in, his secretary went in, and he found that the Prime Minister was on his knees with his son on his back, and he was going around the room playing with the son. So from the son's point of view, he doesn't see the position that, oh, he's such a Prime Minister of the country, I can't be riding horse on him. I mean, I'm treating him like a horse. He doesn't think that. He's got such a friendly relation. So Krishna provides that opportunity for a bhakta, that because if the devotee is sincerely cultivating out of love for and accepting, tolerating what Krishna gives, and happily concentrating on putting his efforts on utilizing his time in that way, then Krishna only reciprocates in such a way. So that's how he plays with his cowherd boys. Also how he on the other hand, with Kans and Shishupal, they are also remembering Krishna. He said we should always remember Krishna, but remembering Krishna has to be also with in such a way that it pleases Krishna. Otherwise, remembering Krishna, Sahajas also remember Krishna. Kans and Shishupal, Krishna gave them mukti, but they did not get bhakti, and they didn't get the entrance to the spiritual world. So, ultimately, remembering Krishna has to be in such a way, it's like a surrendered soul, someone who is completely subordinate, very happily, and not just to Krishna, but Krishna is most happy when we are completely subordinate to a devotee of a devotee, a servant of a servant of the servant. And we have that attitude of being completely happy in that position, serving others in that mood, oblivious of our age or our education or whatever backgrounds we have. On a living entity's level, on a human being's level, Krishna is most pleased, because that really gives him the highest pleasure. Similarly, when Satyabhama was very upset because Rukmini Devi got the Parijat flower and she wanted the Parijat tree, Krishna got it, and he also waged the war with Indra just for that. Now, so Prabhupada and the Acharyas actually used the word henpecked for saying Krishna was like a henpecked husband. So this is a reciprocation of love, and he acts in a role which is to show how he reciprocates with his devotees. Yashoda Mai bound Krishna also, you know, with her love, with the ropes of which actually are by her love, and Krishna allows it. So bhakti is very powerful, and therefore through bhakti we try to be a bhakta, and we accept Supreme Person of Godhead as the whole and soul, the only eternal truth. And that, Prabhupada said, is the real intelligence. That's why when I first read it, I thought it is perhaps it's a exaggeration of sort, or, you know, it's like a sentiment, but that, you know, devotees are the most intelligent. Prabhupada said that. And I used to think that intelligent means, well, you know, somebody has double PhDs, or somebody has got this discovery, that discovery. But now we understand that, I mentioned about this very creative genius, really had such a thing, but at the end of the day, he was miserable and he kept his body frozen just to think that he will get some life. So he had no understanding. So even a child would have known more. Well, on the other hand, if we accept Krishna's authority and supremacy, then we are in a different zone. And also the beauty of bhakti is that whatever progress we make, it is completely, nothing is lost. If we are 1% Krishna conscious, then next life we will be starting at 1%. If you're at 70%, it will be at 70% and beyond. Everything else is, what is material, is destroyed completely. You know, you may have crores in the bank balance, you may have many patents, nothing we can carry with us when we go past this life. But devotion is something which can, this is not to say that we should give Krishna in installments. This is like a book distribution, we pay in installments. This has to be immediate, advance. So, but it is a, it's a, not only, it's very gratifying to know that, but also we understand how Krishna is so kind. That he, just one step towards him and he is willing to extend himself fully. He's just waiting for us to come back. Radhanath Maharaj gave a very nice example of, like, you know, oftentimes we may even take to devotional service and then we have a, we break away. We get trapped in our own, you know, different, means we have a, we deviate, let's say. So Maharaj said that it is very difficult because, so then we say it's a fall down. So he explained very nicely, he said, fall down means what? Fall down only means that what you have, it's actually locked away. Means you don't have access to it, it is yours. He said that Krishna consciousness, whatever progress you made, it is yours. But at the same time, it is locked in a bank vault. So the situation is very tragic because the person, if he is deviated and he is living in a miserable life, it's like a person who's on the roads, is a pauper, but he has got crores in the bank next door, but he has no access. It is there, it is his, but he has no access. And the key to it is to turn towards Krishna, and when you turn towards Krishna and humbly surrender, then Krishna will decide, either he gives you back the full wealth, that means he gives you back your full, or he may give in parts, depending on what is best for us. So it's like we, so anyway, in one sense, it is, it's a sorry situation, very pathetic that person is not knowing that he has so much wealth, because he is willing, he is throwing it away, but it's actually his. But on the other hand, we also know that it is there, it is not gone. It's temporarily inaccessible to him, but nevertheless, the access is possible if we swallow our ego and come back to Krishna. So applying Krishna, Bhagavad Gita in our life really means that we should stop adjusting to material nature and start adjusting to adjusting our consciousness. So instead of external, it is really internal, basically. That's the meaning of Krishna consciousness. Take Krishna, shelter of Krishna. And how do we take shelter of Krishna? The best way is the sadhana process. We all know that. And in that also, the most important is to take the chanting of the holy names of the Lord. And this happens to be the World Holy Name Week, which is also very, just to highlight the critical importance. While we chant every day, there is why a week is dedicated all over the world in unison with ISKCON. And all the 800 odd centers in every continent, every town, every town and every country is primarily because to really bring the importance of chanting of the holy names. So when you talk of reciprocation with Krishna, how do we reciprocate? It isn't something that we have to tangibly, you know, accumulate, save and then buy a gift for him. We can do that and give it to Radha Gopinath ji on Radha Ashtami or Janmashtami. That is part of the process. But that's not 2 days in a year or 3-4 days in a year. This is a moment-to-moment, day-to-day basis. So, since we are not moment-to-moment, at least on a daily basis, we have this process of taking the holy names, the Maha Mantra, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. So, if we can take this with all sincerity, it's the quality that counts, and there's a limited quantity that we have been given as a minimum. But the quality is very important, that we do it not as a mechanical way, but understanding that Krishna is present in his sound, that he is, that's my gateway to Krishna consciousness. My connection, my ticket to Krishna, my connection is really through the holy names. So the holy name becomes our savior, our lifeline, you know, our ticket, and there's no cost to it except our consciousness. And that too, mathematically in 24 hours, we're given only a 5%. What bargain it is that in 95% you do what you want, well, within bounds, But nevertheless, you have got more. 5% we give to Krishna just to thank Him that He is giving us 100%. So therefore, if you can take this holy name even more seriously, all are chanting, all of us, and the message is for all of us that we need reminders. And this becomes a reminder, how do we redouble our effort, how do we examine, you know, how we are, what we are doing so far. Because here it's not measured by time factor in the sense that because I'm now 20 years or 10 years or 5 years or 15 years in the movement, therefore I have now come to a stage where I don't need to do it. On the contrary, there's a risk that we may be complacent. So we have to be, how do we rekindle our enthusiasm for the holy name? There is a very nice Mahatma Prabhu has given, many of you may have seen it, you know, he said affirmations, and it's worthwhile keeping it and just putting it in key places in your house. These affirmations are like about 15 or so of them, you know, that I want to chant, I love to chant, I will chant. So when you say this, then it just is a reminder. And even if you're walking or sitting, we understand that it is not a mechanical thing, I've taken the beads and I'm doing it. That is my ticket to back to Godhead. It's my, you know, that's the only way I will be able to surrender to Krishna, etc., etc. So it's very nicely given. But whatever ways we get, and there are lots of ways, there's so many things, if it's consciousness is to put a focus. So let's take full advantage of this week to remind ourselves where we are and utilize our time in such a way that Krishna can be happy and Prabhupada would be also happy with us. Hare Krishna. Thank you. Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai.